Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So Alexander's in our systems and networking group here in the lab, doing a lot of work around not just the the pure research, but also a lot sort of the data centers. And we'll be talking about cloud computing later, so more from the user side. But this is kind of more at the bare metal and doing some really groundbreaking work. And Alexander had his PhD from EPFL, right?
So yeah.
Anybody from EPFL? There might be some people here from EPFL.
Yeah.
So take it away, Alexander.
Yes, thanks for the introduction. So, hi everyone. Today I'm going to talk about FaRM, which is our distributed computing platform for modern data center hardware. And this is basically one of the projects in systems and networking that's looking into the future of data centers. So there are a few other projects or efforts basically looking into what the data centers of tomorrow are going to look like and how we should build the software for those data centers. And so, as I told you, FaRM is one of the projects basically in that space. And FaRM was very much motivated by these two hardware trends. One is basically that the cost of main memory has gone down significantly, and today it's basically cost effective to put hundreds to gigabytes of DRAM to a terabyte in a single commodity server. And that means that a small cluster of several tens of machines can already have tens to hundreds of terabytes of DRAM. And that's enough to store the entire data sets of many applications. Okay, so putting the data entire data set in memory of machines really helps improve performance because the data is not accessed, is not accessed on secondary storage commonly. So this improves performance significantly. But once the data is in main memory, actually the traditional networking stack becomes the bottleneck, right? Accessing the data in memory of a remote machine over TCP is very slow. It doesn't work really well. Fortunately, we have this other trend, and we have these new data center networks. So these are basically high-performance computing networks from several years ago that are making their ways into data centers and are becoming commodity. And they have really good performance, so 40 gigabits of throughput this year. And we are actually expecting 100 gigabits later this year or at the beginning of next year. And then very, very low latency, so several microseconds of latency. So just to give an example, I'll show later a comparison of latency with a TCP-based network. And also they have these RDMA primitives, which are actually quite interesting. So RDMA stands for Remote Direct Memory Access, and these primitives enable reading and writing data in memory of remote machines. So essentially what happens is that the Nikon remote machine performs a DMA request on behalf of the sender. So just to give you an example here, I'm showing two machines, machine A and B, and machine A wants to read some data from memory of machine B. Okay? And so to do this, basically the CPU initiates the request, machine A initiates the request with the local NIC, which then sends the request to NIC in machine B. And at this point, what happens in a traditional networking stacks, basically the NIC would deliver the message to the CPU, which would then serve the request. But with RDMA, basically the NIC does not interrupt the CPU. It directly sets up the DMA transfer with local memory, fetches the data, and sends the data back. And then the data gets stored in memory of machine A. And so this basically removes the CPU from the path of serving the data, which improves performance. Okay. And so FaRM is a lot about how to actually use these new primitives that the network exposes. So how to use this new, networking abstraction that the modern networks expose, and how to use it to build modern data distributed systems. And in FaRM, we use RDMA extensively. So we basically use RDMA reads to read data from memory of remote machines. And we also use RDMA writes to implement very efficient messaging layer, which exposes a common abstraction or abstraction similar to what today's networks do. And RDMA gives us really great performance. One of the reasons is that it bypasses the kernel, so we can access the NICs directly. And another one is that we bypass the remote CPU, okay, which further improves performance. So just to tell you what I mean by great performance, here is a performance comparison with today's networks. So here we set up a simple micro benchmark. We have 20 machines. They're connected with 40 gigabit Rocky network that supports RDMA and Ethernet. Each machine continuously issues requests to other machines in the cluster. Each request goes to a randomly selected machine and to a randomly selected offset in the exposed memory in that cluster. And basically, machines read data using three different mechanisms. One is the one at the bottom is basically doing TCP over, basically using doing RPC or traditional TCP, so something that you would see in today's data centers. Okay, and y-axis shows millions of requests per second per server here. The red line is RDMA messaging, so this is basically using RDMA writes to implement this efficient messaging. And as you can see, already we are seeing here a factor of 10 basically improvement in throughput compared to the TCP, which is quite good. But if you're able to use RDMA reads, so to directly read data without interrupting the CPU on the remote end, we can actually get another factor of 2 of performance improvement. Yes?
Ask you one question. Yes. Are we assuming that there's no switch between the two machines?
No. This works across switches and across basically multiple switches or even routers. So I was just simplifying the exposition.
Okay. So basically, we are seeing a factor of 2 performance improvement. And the reason why we are seeing the factor of 2 is actually that RDMA reads require half the number of messages of network level messages of doing RDMA messaging over writes. Okay? And today we are basically network bound, so we are seeing this factor of 2. But actually we are very close to being CPU bound here. Especially for even in this simple micro benchmark, you're almost using all CPU on the machine just to do messaging over RDMAs. So in the future, we expect this gap actually to increase. Because the system is CPU bound, we are going to have faster networks which will support high request rates. We actually expect this gap to increase to 3 or 4x already with the next generation of hardware. Okay, so and also one more thing just to mention here. So basically, I'm showing here requests per second per server. So the here in this region, we're basically request rate bound. So we're bound by the number of requests that the NICs can process on the NIC, and here we're starting to become bandwidth bound. So this is why we are seeing fewer requests per second per server. So the performance is actually not dropping. We're basically becoming bandwidth bound there. Okay, so what does the latency look like? So this is the lowest latency in a similar micro benchmark. So here we have two machines talking to each other, only having a single outstanding request to the other machine. And we have a similar story, right? So we again are seeing an order of magnitude improvement in the lowest latency that we are seeing. And latency is sometimes even more important than throughput, because often the applications running in data centers are actually bound by the latency of the network requests. Okay, so these networks have really great performance. So this is really good for data center applications that have irregular data access patterns and that are latency sensitive. And examples of these applications are graph stores or key value stores. So these applications that are typically run in today's data centers that are attracting lots of attention lately. And so what we expect and what we are trying to do is if we can expose this new hardware basically to the applications in the application programmers in the right way, we should enable much better performance of the existing applications, and also we expect to enable new functionality and new applications in the future. And so that's basically our goal. Okay? So in the rest of the talk, I'm going to tell you about FaRM programming model and what is the model that you actually expose to the programmers, and then a little bit about the design and implementation of FaRM, and then some experimental results. So when starting with this project, we asked ourselves the question of how to program a modern cluster. Okay, so this is basically one of the main questions that we asked. And by a modern cluster, I mean a cluster with terabytes of DRAM, hundreds of CPU cores, and the RDMA network. So what I already told you so far. And in this work, basically, and here we have a small cluster of 20 machines, which already has 2.5 terabytes of DRAM and 320 CPU cores, and this 40 gigabit network that supports both Ethernet and RDMA. So already a small cluster of 20 machines is quite powerful. And today we can buy even more powerful clusters of the similar size. So we would like, based on the characteristics of the hardware and our results from our micro benchmarks, we would like to keep the applications keep the data in main memory, okay? We would like them to access data using RDMA as much as possible because this gives us significant performance improvements, yes.
Shouldn't we consider some kind of backing store? Our routes, we wouldn't have any fault tolerance for their power failure,
yes,
or server failure.
Yes,
I'll talk about this, but basically the idea, we have multiple answers to this question. One is that basically we are starting to see these emerging non-volatile memories, which actually do not lose contents once the power goes. Non-volatile memories. So they basically have these memory stores or PCM memories that do not lose their contents when the power goes off. We can sort of emulate this by putting a small amount of flash to get on the DIMM and having the logic to actually flush the cache when the power goes off, and then have a small amount of power in these ultra capacitors just to have enough power to flush everything to cache, so the data again is safe. What we actually do here in this project is we actually keep the data in main memory, but we still log SSD. So on failures, we can a bit more. I won't go into the fault tolerance a lot, but we basically store the data on SSDs, and then SSDs just to recover. Okay, but the whole copy of data is in main memory, and SSDs are just for recovery. So we can access data on the common path just in memory, and then we use SSDs only for fault recovery.
How often would we dump to SSD?
So we essentially write to SSDs. I'll tell you about our. We don't dump onto SSDs. We continuously write the data to SSDs. I'll get back to that in a few slides. Okay. Thanks. So another thing that we would like to do is also to enable actually access to data in local memory, okay? So we would like to collocate data in computation to basically enable applications to access data in local memory as much as possible, because accessing data in local memory is still much faster than accessing data in remote memory. Basically, we are seeing about a factor of 20 of difference between RDMA and just reading data from local memory, okay? And so this is what basically are our goals. So how do we do that? We basically, FaRM has a symmetric model, so applications written from FaRM actually run in a model where machines store both the data and execute the application. And the reason for this is actually to enable access to local memory, which is much faster than accessing data in remote memory. And this is sort of different from traditional setups where we have a bunch of machines that store the data, like in a database or maybe in a memory caching layer, and then there's another distinct set of machines that actually are executing the application logic. Yes.
I'm not sure I understood so far.
Okay.
What are the similarities and the differences with Azure caching? Is it something complementary? Is it something? Is the same?
So you mean memory caching?
Yes. No, Azure caching. The Azure caching service.
So the difference is that the caching. In any caching, like Memcached, for instance, or Azure caching service, basically just keeps a cache of data in main memory. Okay, so there's basically a backing store. In our case, we actually keep all the data in main memory. In addition, we also basically execute the servers. Also execute the applications. In this project, I'll tell you in the next few slides about the programming model that we expose to the applications. So our applications are completely written to the FaRM. For the FaRM system, right? So this is not just a caching service. It could be used to implement a caching service, but it's more general. Okay. So basically, having this symmetric model with the applications, the same machine stores the data and executes the application, actually enables this fast local access. Another reason for actually having the symmetric model is that if we access data over RDMA a lot, then basically the server-side CPUs are underutilized. So the CPU is not utilized for accessing the data. So having a symmetric model actually lets us use these sort of otherwise spare cycles. Okay? And so the programming model that we expose to the applications is this of shared address space. So FaRM builds a shared address space out of memory of all machines in the cluster. And then the applications can basically allocate, delete, and manipulate objects in this shared address space. The reason for going for the shared address space is actually our desire to support direct access to objects over RDMA. Okay, so in order to perform an RDMA access, we need to know the address and the size of the transfer. And this naturally basically pushes us towards the shared address space model. This is slightly different from previous systems that expose distributed systems or shared data space, where the main goal was actually to improve programmability. Okay, for us, the main desire is to actually improve performance, and programmability is basically a very welcome bonus. Okay, and so what can applications do in this shared data space? So we basically expose this very general primitive. We expose transactions, and we basically expect the programmers to be able to write the entire application just using transactions. So as you probably know, the transactions enable atomic execution of multiple operations, and the operations that we expose are basically reads of objects, writes of objects in this shared data space. Applications can also allocate and free objects in this shared data space. So these are basically primitives you would expect from any shared address space system, like a single machine, for instance. Okay? And transactions, as I told you, are a very general primitive, and we expect the programmers to be able to write the entire application using transactions. We support very strong consistency. Basically, we support serializability, which simplifies reasoning about the systems and the programs. And basically, using transactions makes programming much simpler. So basically, we make location of objects transparent, we make concurrency in this very highly concurrent system transparent, and we also make failures transparent. Basically, if a machine fails, we recover the data, and this is completely hidden from the application. Yes.
By transparent concurrency.
So when using transactions, basically programmers are completely hidden from the fact that there are a lot of other threads executing code on the same objects. So by just using transactions, basically they have this serial world view of the world. I'll get back to that, I think, in a few slides.
Or lock.
No, so this is all handled by the system, right? So you just write a transaction using this interface, and basically the system below deals with all the concurrency and failures and hides it from the application. Okay. So this is the API that the programmer can use to write transactions. So this is slightly simplified API to do that. And FaRM has these optimistic transactions. So the program needs to start a transaction first and then executes a bunch of operations inside. I already told you we support allocation, freeing of objects, and also reads and writes of objects. And then when the program is finished executing operation inside the transaction, it invokes TX commit. And at this point, basically, the runtime checks whether the transaction can be atomically committed. Okay, if it can, it atomically applies all the effects of the transaction. Otherwise, it returns true. Otherwise, it does nothing and returns false. Basically, at that point, the application, if it typically just restarts the same transaction. So this is basically an example of an optimistic concurrency control primitive, where you execute an operation, hoping that, and then basically in the end, you validate and check whether the operation can be atomically applied. Okay. Yes.
In TX alloc that there is an address hint parameter.
Yes, yes.
Does that mean it's up to the program to hint at what data it wants to keep local? Or is that something that the FaRM infrastructure guesses for the program?
No, the FaRM infrastructure doesn't guess it. So basically, yes, this is what you said. So we enable actually collocating multiple objects together. I'll get back to that in two slides. Okay? So, but as you can see, apart from this, this is the same programming model, the same programming API you would actually see, you would actually use on a single machine system. So basically, all the details about the distribution are hidden from the programmer, the programmer wants to do that. And so we expect the program can use this very simple model to write any kind of the application. We also expose two additional primitives to actually enable further optimization of the code. Okay, so if the programmer wants to squeeze the last bit of performance out of this cluster, then they can use these two primitives when necessary. Okay, so one of the primitives are lock-free reads. So lock-free reads are essentially enable atomic execution of a single read. So this is an atomic execution of a single object, reading a single object atomically. Okay, the difference between lock-free reads and transactions is that when the application performs multiple reads, there is no guarantee across multiple reads. So there is no guarantee that multiple reads are consistent, mutually consistent. These operations are really great because they're efficient. We implement them with a single RDMA read, they're also strongly consistent. So they're basically serializable. So you can think of each log-free read as a transaction that consists of a single read. Okay. The downside of using transaction log-free reads is that they're harder to compose than transactions. So there's basically no guarantee that there are multiple reads are mutually consistent. So you might observe an inconsistent snapshot of the system. So if the programmer really wants to use these log-free reads, then the concurrency is not hidden anymore. Okay, but they can be used, and I'll tell you how to improve performance. Another optimization is basically related to locality awareness. So if you just allocate objects in the system, treating it as a shared address space, what we might end up is having some related data, for instance, a graph of a few items that are commonly accessed together, like in this example, it can get basically distributed across the whole cluster. Okay, but if you know that this data is accessed together commonly, what we would like is actually to allocate it on a single server. Okay, and then when the data is allocated in a single server, we would also like to be able to ship the computation to that server and basically send an RPC to the machine that holds the data, which then can locally perform all the accesses, okay, and return the result if necessary. This basically enables this local access to local data, which is still faster than doing it over RDMA. In addition, we also have these optimized single server transactions. This basically further promotes the use of locality awareness. So collocating the related data together and shipping the computation to this related data. And the way we actually do this is by using the address hint. Okay? When allocating the object, the programmer has an option of providing the address. If the programmer provides the address, then the system tries really hard to allocate the data close to the provided hint address. And it also tries really hard to keep the data together even after failures or machine additions. Okay? And another primitive is basically sending a message to a server that holds a particular address. So you can basically send an RPC to ship the computation. So this is how we actually express these locality optimizations. So just to sum up, basically, FaRM programming model FaRM exposes the shared address space to the applications, and they can run fully general distributed transactions to write the majority of their code, okay, in a simple manner. And then we expose two options for optimization. One is using log-free reads, and another is using these locality awareness or locality optimizations. Okay, so just to get back to what I mean by the strongly consistent model. And why is concurrency hidden from the programmers? So we opted to go for strong consistency in FaRM. This is again slightly different from many of the modern systems that actually opt to go for weaker consistency to improve performance. We go for strong consistency basically to make it simpler for programmers to reason about this distributed, highly concurrent failure-prone system. Okay. So what this means is that we support strict serializability for transactions, and we support serializability for data structures that we implement on top of FaRM, like hash tables. What this means is, let me show you this, what this means on an example. Let's say that we have two threads executing in our system, and then every thread is going to perform some operation, right? And the operation is going to consist of several steps, and each step is basically a log-free read or an operation inside a transaction, okay? And these operations are going to be executed concurrently by multiple threads. So what our system guarantees is basically that there is always, and this is a standard property, is basically that there always exists a serial execution equivalent to the actual execution, where each operation serializes or linearizes to a single point in time between its start and end. Okay? And so basically this makes it possible to reason about the system in terms of a sequential system, and this is why it hides concurrency. This is also true even in the face of failure, so it hides failures too. And to implement this, we needed to make some timing assumption, because this is a distributed system, and we make some basic common timing assumptions. So basically eventual synchrony and bounded CPU clock drift. So these are the basic common assumptions that are considered in these distributed systems. Okay, yes.
Op2 a conflict, so that Op2 say writes the data that was read by Op1.
Yes. So then basically, if it really depends. They can be serialized in an order, right? If the system detects that the actual execution does not correspond to a serial order, it's going to abort some of the operations, right? And redo the operations.
So up one might be aborted and then restarted?
Yes.
Okay. But from the point of view of the programmer doesn't, in principle, even see that the operation has been aborted, right? We can just restart the operation.
Okay,
so the operation keeps trying to get executed until it finally commits, and then it serializes at some point. Yes?
Is there any way to guarantee that operation one will be at some point executed? Because it can always, it's a classical problem of distributed
yes.
system, it can actually have that the operation one is always aborted. And
yes, the operation one, there are some techniques to ensure that. So. What we typically do is we basically rely on the back off. So if a transaction keeps aborting, we try backing off a bit longer in order to actually reduce contention and try to commit it. Right? There are other options, but this is what we use, and it works in practice, in our experience, quite well. Okay. So this is basically the programming model of FaRM. So very strong consistent strong consistency. Next, I'm going to tell you a little bit about design and implementation, how we actually implement this interface. And just looking at the FaRM, so FaRM consists of several components here, basically. And then on top of FaRM, we built two applications, so key value store and the graph store. Okay, and I won't have enough time to talk about all the layers in FaRM, but what I want to tell you is that we actually carefully designed and implemented the algorithms in all of these layers, so they actually perform quite well, and they all contribute to the performance of FaRM. So, just as an example, our communication layer is, for instance, by a factor of 8 faster than by just using RDMA out of the box. Okay, using a shared address space actually enables directly accessing data, which is again by a factor of 2 faster than going to the data through a key value store, which is typically done in today's applications. Our RDMA reads, I already told you, are performed with a single, our lock-free reads are performed with a single RDMA, so they are a factor of 2 faster than actually sending a message to the server that holds the data. And our FaRM hash table is by a factor of 3, the algorithm is by a factor of 3 better than previously published RDMA-based hash tables. So these are all significant factors, which add up actually to a really good performance in practice. So we are seeing by a factor of 24 better performance than a previously published RDMA hash table, and we are seeing between 10 and 40, a factor of 10 and 40 improvement in throughput over TCP, state-of-the-art TCP-based key value store, something that you would see running in data centers today. Okay? So, as I told you, I don't have time to talk about all of this, but I'll tell you about the synchronization primitives and the FaRM hash table. Yes?
The communication itself, is it done on top of TCP or of something similar with infinite band? Or?
Yeah, so it is done basically. So what we do is actually we use this Rocky combination of infinite band and Ethernet. So these networks support both Ethernet and infinite band like primitives, RDMA. So this is why they are actually making their way into data centers, because you can use them to run legacy applications, and you can also actually use these more advanced, better performing primitives. Okay. But it is essentially the programming model that InfiniBand exposes. What we had to do is we actually had to do several optimizations to the way we allocate and register memory for access over RDMA, and this is where this factor of 8 comes from. Okay. Yes.
Will the architecture support a shared memory style of inter-process communication rather than message passing, or is either just as fine?
You can do either. Yes. So what do you mean by shared memory communication? So we have objects which you can update and read. So this enables communication between different. Or are you more concerned with? Conditional variable kind of communication.
Yeah, with conditional variables like that.
So no, we don't support that. We basically rely on we support messaging instead. I guess we could implement a similar primitive as well, but we just didn't do that.
Okay, and here we might consider messages, RPCs.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So. Let me first tell you how we implement transactions, how transactions are implemented. So I already told you we have these fully general distributed transactions.
So a transaction is always executed by a single server, in this case, server S1, which is called the coordinator. But it can access objects anywhere in the cluster, basically objects in memory of any of the machines in the cluster. And to read objects, we use RDMA reads. Okay? When updating an object, we basically buffer the writes, so the writes do not become visible immediately to the rest of the threads running in the system. Okay? And actually, the updates get applied during the commit phase. So to commit, we basically use a modified two-phase commit protocol. So what we do is we basically first lock the objects. So to do that, we send RDMA messages and have the servers lock the objects in the write set. Okay? We don't lock the objects in the read set. Instead, we actually validate the read set. So this means that we actually check whether the objects have changed since we read them during the execution of the transaction. We do this again using RDMA reads, and if the objects have not changed, we can then apply the updates. And we do this in the final step, which is basically update and unlock. So we send RDMA one-way RDMA messages to the machines that have pieces of our write set, and then they update. So the reason why we can send one-way messages is that we have this reliable in-order transport that is exposed from the network, so we rely on it. So I'm omitting here two things. One is actually that we have these optimized single server transactions, okay, which send fewer messages if all the objects are co-located on the same server. And another is actually logging to SSD. So what happens during this commit phase is actually we send the data to other machines, which then log the updates locally to SSDs. And we can use this to recover data on failures. And this is rather similar to, for instance, what's done in the system. Some of you might have heard about RAM Cloud, right? So it is quite comparable. Okay. Yes.
In the execution phase, those first two RDMA communications, are those reads?
Yes.
They want to read memory that is locked.
Yes.
Would they wait?
I'm getting to that.
Third time's a charm.
Yes. This is how you implement transactions. So I'll next tell you how we use lock-free reads. Okay. And during transaction execution, we actually perform the same thing. So we basically do the lock-free reads to get a consistent state of the object, right? Which we then, at a later point, serialize. So we use the same thing, but we can use lock-free reads outside transactions too. Because transactions can be expensive and require many messages, and sometimes applications do not need that level of consistency, or they can ensure it using some application-specific tricks, we also expose lock-free reads, as I already told you. Lock-free reads are very efficient, so they're performed with a single RDMA read in the common case, and they return a consistent state of the object read. And you can think of them as basically equivalent to a transaction that consists of a single RDMA read. Okay? So how do we implement lock-free reads? Let me first tell you how you would implement lock-free reads on a single machine, a shared machine system. So basically, what we would do is we would put the header in, we would put the version in the header of the object, and then updating the object, the updater would first lock the header word, then update the data, and then unlock and increment the version. So when reading the data, we can read the version, the data, and then the version again, and if the two values of the version observed are equal, we have a consistent state of the object, if the object is unlocked. Otherwise, we might have observed an inconsistent state of the object, so we need to restart the read. Okay, so this is basically another example of the optimistic concurrency control scheme. And just a note here, basically, we need to avoid a wraparound of versions for the duration of the read. So we need to use 64-bit versions, basically, in the header to avoid the overflow. So this is practically enough to ensure that. So this is a great way of implementing lock-free reads on a shared memory system, on a single machine, because it actually avoids having to log the object when reading. So it avoids invalidating the cache lines when reading. So this is good. But it's not really great for our system, right? Because this actually requires three network accesses to perform a single read. And we would like to do it with a single RDMA, right? If we had to actually do three network accesses for a single read, we might just as well send the message to the remote server and have it return us doing the read over RDMA, okay? So we need to do something else.
So how do we implement log-free reads in FaRM? So we start from the same starting point. We put the version in the header. And then we use characteristics of our hardware. So our hardware is cache coherent. And what this means is that the NIC actually observes updates inside the same, inside a single cache line in the same order in which they are performed by the CPU. So we have the ordering guarantees inside the cache line, but there are no ordering guarantees across cache lines. So we use this. So what we do is we put a cache line version in each of the cache lines of the object. Okay? When updating the object, we basically lock all the cache lines and update the data and unlock and increment, again, all the cache lines. And note that this is not much more expensive than basically just updating a single version because this happens locally. So this happens during the commit phase of a transaction, and this happens basically. These are all local accesses. But having this scheme actually enables us to perform a single RDMA read that fetches the whole object, and then we can check the versions. If the versions match, we have a consistent, and they're not locked, we have a consistent state of the object. Otherwise, we have an inconsistent state that we basically discard the results and perform the read again. Okay? So this is the way we actually do log-free reads in FaRM. And this works fine, but there is actually a problem here. And the problem is the space overhead of this scheme. Okay? So each cache line is 64 bytes, and if we use 8-byte versions, which we need to use to avoid wraparound, then we incur 12.5% of space overhead. And this is quite high in a system that keeps all data in memory. We would like to avoid this if possible. So what we do, it's actually possible to avoid or to reduce the space overhead in the following way. So what we do is we keep only 16, we use only 16-bit cache line versions. Okay? So we keep, we have the header version that is 64 bits, so we keep the 8-byte header version, and then use the least, store the least significant 2 bytes of the header version in each of the cache lines. And the reason why this works is that actually we need to avoid wraparound of cache line versions only for the duration of a single RDMA read. Okay? So to be safe, what we do is we measure how long it takes to perform a single RDMA, to perform the RDMA read. And if it takes longer than it would take an updater to wrap around cache line versions, we abort the read and restart it again. Okay? So just to give you an example, let's say that for a particular size of the object, it takes 40, the minimum amount of time to update an object is 40 nanoseconds. So the minimum amount means the object is in cache and it's being updated by a local updater continuously, basically. Okay? So the maximum amount of time the RDMA read can take, and we can still be sure that there were no wraparounds, is this. So 40 nanoseconds times 2 to the power 16, because we have 16 bits, times 1 minus epsilon, which is a factor that accounts for clock drift. Okay, so what actually happens in practice is that CPU clocks go at slightly different rates. So we account for this by this factor. And in this particular case, I'm using 0.2, which is quite a generous factor. And basically, the maximum amount of time we allow for RDMA reads to take and still accept the result is 2 milliseconds. Okay? And because we have such a fast network, we actually, in practice, never have to abort log-free reads because of these timeouts. Okay? So this is how this is a trick that we basically use to reduce space overheads significantly and still be able to do log-free reads with a single RDMA. Okay, so this is all I'm going to tell you about the core FaRM primitives, but you can ask me about them, about other things later if you would like. Next, I'll tell you how we actually use these primitives to implement a hash table, which is basically a building block for many distributed systems. Think of key-value stores that are being produced and used every day. Okay, so we have this very interesting FaRM hash table algorithm. So I think even if you're not that interested in RDMA or the systems, this is still a part of the talk that's worth paying attention to. So our hash table is optimized for lookups. Basically, the reason is that the majority of accesses in the modern data center workloads are lookups. So basically, 95% or more of all operations are lookups. And so our goal for the hash table is to perform a lookup, perform a hash table lookup with a single RDMA read, okay? And we do update with transactions, which simplifies updates, obviously. But what we also do is we, for performance, we ship updates to the server that holds the data. With the hash table, because of the properties of the hash table, we know which server holds the data, so we can simply ship the data to the server. And for correctness, basically, we want to ensure reusability, which I mentioned a few slides ago. Okay, so how do we implement distributed hash table? So essentially, the distributed hash table, FaRM distributed hash table, another hash table looks like this. So we have a bunch of servers, and each of the servers has several shards, so several basically chunks of the bucket array. Okay, and then what we do is we use consistent one-hop hashing, basically to map the key to the host shard and to the host server. So this is what's done for a distributed hash table in any case. But where it gets interesting is what happens when we know what shard the key belongs to. So how do we implement this shard, basically the hash table, what the algorithm we use inside the shard to support reads with a single RDMA. So a simple first example would be to use chaining. Okay, we could inline the data in the bucket array, so keep the data itself in the bucket array, and then use overflow chaining basically to deal with collisions. And this is a simple scheme that you, the probably the simplest hash table to implement. And the FaRM programming model enables you to do all of this because we have objects, we have pointers, and you can implement the chaining hash table. To perform a lookup, you would need to perform a single RDMA lookup read to basically read the bucket from the bucket array and then potentially follow the overflow chains. But the hope here would be that in the common case, you would have only a single RDMA read, okay? And that we wouldn't have that many overflow chains. And if that's the case, we are done. We have our FaRM hash table that performs lookups with a single RDMA read in the common case. Well, unfortunately, this is not the case. What actually happens is this. So here, I'm showing how many RDMA reads we need to perform on average to perform a single lookup for different levels of occupancy. Okay? And occupancy is the ratio between the number of elements that we inserted in the hash table and the capacity of the bucket array. Okay? And you can see with high occupancies, which we actually want in a main memory system such as FaRM, we need almost two RDMA reads to perform a single lookup. So again, this defeats the purpose of using RDMA to perform lookups. We could just as well, send RPCs to do that. Yes.
If there is a collision, isn't all the chain located in the same machine? I would assume. Then I don't understand from where the second read comes from.
So basically what we can do with RDMA, we can read a contiguous piece of memory, okay? So we can read the bucket. But then if there's an overflow chain, the overflow chain is actually going to be a different object. Is going to be assigned an address, and we need to perform another RDMA read to read the object in the chain, and potentially multiple of them to follow the whole chain, right? So this is where the 1.8 something comes from. Okay, but so basically, this just shows us that this particular design is not great if we want to get the best possible performance out of the system. So we had to do something else, and what we do, we started from this hopscotch hash table. So this is a very interesting hash table that was actually designed for a single machine system. So this is a concurrent hash table. And it basically relies on the invariant. It maintains the invariant that an element is always in the neighborhood of the home bucket. So basically of the bucket the key hashes to. So what this means is that if you want to perform a lookup, you need basically to only inspect several neighboring buckets in the array. And then we can actually fetch all the buckets with a single RDMA. Okay, so this would give us basically a lookup with a single RDMA. So note that here we are actually trading off basically number of requests for the size of the request. So essentially, instead of reading a single bucket, so only the data that we want to read, we with this scheme we would read multiple buckets. Okay, but this is fine. Remember, in the micro benchmark, basically the request rate was constant for a wide range of transfer sizes. So we can make this trade-off as long as it's not too bad. As long as we don't need to read a lot more data than we actually need to do that that we're actually looking up. Okay. So this is nice. But how does the hash table actually maintain the invariant? So I'm show this on an example. Let's say that we have this blue neighborhood where all the blue items go into, and then we have an overlapping red neighborhood in which all the red items go to. Okay, and let's say that we have this particular case where we have these four items in the hash table, three blue and one red item. So what happens now when we want to insert a blue item in the hash table? Okay, so the blue neighborhood is basically full, so we cannot just simply insert it there. So you see that what we can do is we basically can displace the red item one slot right, and then we can put the blue item into its position. Okay, and more generally, what we do basically we scan past the end of the neighborhood, try to find an empty slot, and then perform a chain of these displacements to move the empty slot basically inside the neighborhood that in which we are inserting the key value pair. Okay, and so yes.
An insert can be O of N, big O of N?
So what happens is basically, well, in principle, but what you can do is you can just give up at some point, deciding that or concluding that the hash table is too full. And this is what actually happens, because sometimes even if you would scan the whole hash table, you wouldn't be able to yes, basically what you do when displacing does not work, you resize the hash table, okay? Reinsert all elements in the hash table. And what the authors do in the original paper, they basically use a neighborhood size of 32 elements. And the reason is actually to support higher occupancy. So basically they support occupancies of 95% or more, right? But to do this, they use neighborhoods of 32 elements, which is fine in a single machine system, because you can scan all the 32 elements without too high performance overheads. But in our case, this actually does not work really well. So we cannot really afford to read 32 times more data than we actually need to. This would degrade performance, okay? So we can afford to read a small neighborhood, but not a neighborhood of size of 32 elements. So we needed to do something slightly different. So what does the FaRM hash table look like? So we basically start from the hopscotch algorithm, but we keep the neighborhood small. And then if instead of actually resizing the hash table, we use overflow chaining. Okay, so this is why we can support again high occupancies. And the idea here is that actually hopscotch algorithm is so good in finding empty slots inside the hash table that we won't have that many overflow chains. So this is going to be much better than the chaining hash table. In addition, we also for space efficiency basically use associativity. So what we do is we have neighborhoods always consist of two objects, two FaRM objects, and then we put multiple key value pairs inside a single object. Okay, so this lets us amortize the costs of FaRM headers and basically hash table bucket headers. Okay, so basically the FaRM hash table is a combination of three techniques: hopscotch hashing, chaining, and then associativity. Yes?
That last technique didn't quite get the headers show which object is in a bucket.
Yes.
So you have the headers for two buckets in for two objects in one bucket.
Yes, in this particular example, yes, we have basically two key value items in a single FaRM object. Okay? And what we typically do, we put between one and let's say five. And each neighborhood consists of two objects. So what this helps us is actually amortize the cost of FaRM object headers themselves. For instance, a FaRM object has the version, the header version, it has some other metadata inside the object. And if we have very small objects, then keeping this metadata for every object actually amounts to a large space overhead. So we keep multiple key value items in a single FaRM object. Similarly for the hash table, for instance, the hash table has, for instance, a pointer to the overflow bucket, right, which is not always used, but it has the pointer. So it's good to amortize this across multiple key value items if they are small.
Set associative caches.
So it is associativity. So you can always put multiple items in a single bucket. But yes, it's a similar technique. So there's another detail here. So basically, you might be wondering why do we have neighborhoods of two objects instead of keeping the entire neighborhood as a single object. And the reason is that we need overlapping neighborhoods for hopscotch hashing to work.
Okay, so this is why we need multiple objects in a neighborhood. Which leads us to the next problem, and this is how do we read these neighborhoods consistently with a single RDMA? So what FaRM exposes, it lets us read multiple contiguous objects, okay, with a single RDMA read. But then what it guarantees is that each object is going to be, the application is going to observe a consistent state of each object, but not necessarily the consistent state of the whole neighborhood. So let me show an example of what I mean by this. So let's say that we have these four objects in the hash table, and we want to look up the orange item. Okay, so what we do this with a single RDMA read. But what might actually happen in the execution is that the hardware might actually fetch the data of the first object and observe a single and get a consistent state of this first object, so the blue-green state of the first object. But at that point, what might happen is that someone else comes in and removes an object from the hash table. Okay, remember, this is a highly concurrent system. There are lots of operations in progress at any point in time. So if this object removes the green item, this is still fine. So this still does not break consistency of the operation. But what happens actually is that when it removes, we compact the neighborhoods. So what we do is essentially, if there is an overflow chain, we move an item from an overflow chain into the table, so to optimize the lookups, the future lookups. Okay. If there are no overflow chains, as in this example, we still move objects closer to their home bucket, and this is to increase the likelihood of the inserts in the future succeeding. Okay. So what this means is that the orange item is actually going to be moved into the first object, and the purple item is also going to be moved, but it doesn't impact this particular example. And if a transaction commits before the hardware actually issues the reads for the next object, we are going to observe an inconsistent state of the neighborhood. So if we just relied on this single RDMA read, what would happen is if we would not find the orange item. And this is not an acceptable answer, because the orange item is in the hash table. It was in the hash table before we started the operation. So the lookup should return true. And so we need to do something else in order to actually make this work. And this is an example of these data structure specific validation techniques that you need to use if you want, you often need to use if you rely on log-free reads. Okay? So what we do here, we basically introduce neighborhood versions in the hash table. Okay? So we assign a version to every neighborhood and keep these versions in all objects in the neighborhood. So this basically means that every object is going to have to keep two versions, right? One for each of the neighborhoods it's in. And so what we do when performing an update, we basically increment the version of every object. We increment the neighborhood version in all the objects in the neighborhood. Okay. In this particular case, this means that we would actually increment the version v3. Okay. And then we perform an additional consistency check. So basically, we check whether the versions in the two objects in the neighborhood match. If they don't, we know that we observed an inconsistent state of the object, so we redo the read. Otherwise, we can accept the results of the read. Okay. So in this particular case, basically, we would see an old version of v3 in this object, right, in the state of the object that we read, and the new one in the second one, so we would detect the inconsistency. So this is how we deal with this potential problem. Okay, so was doing all of this worth it? So this looks like a complex hash table, and the answer is yes. So here I'm showing again the average number of reads needed to perform a lookup for different levels of occupancy, for the chaining hash table and for the FaRM hash table with a neighborhood size of 8. Okay, and as you can see, we need only 1.08 RDMA reads even at the occupancy of 100, which is much, much better than doing it with chaining. And what's even more interesting is that even when using smaller neighborhoods, we actually can benefit from these techniques. Even with neighborhood size of 2, we still outperform chaining by quite a lot. So this was a nice, unexpected thing from this algorithm. Okay, so I think we're running out of time. So I'll just quickly talk a little bit about the experimental results. We ran a lot of experiments, and if you'd like, you can come and ask me or send me. Actually, I'm doing the demo tomorrow, so stop by and ask any questions you have. So this is basically a comparison of a FaRM key value store to a TCP state-of-the-art based key value store, so something you would see running in the data centers today. In this particular example, we are running across this cluster of 20 machines with 40 gigabit RDMA and Rocky network. On the y-axis, I'm showing millions of lookups per second. Key value items, keys are 16 bytes and values are 32 bytes, okay? So which is a typical size for evaluating these kinds of systems. And as you can see, FaRM hash table is basically by a factor of 15 faster than the state-of-the-art TCP-based hash table at 20 servers, which is a very significant performance improvement. What's even more important in many cases is actually latency. So here I'm showing the latency at the peak throughput. So basically the same experiment, right? This is the experiment with the concurrency that maximizes the throughput, and this shows the latency at that throughput. And as you can see, we are seeing two orders of magnitude better latency than basically TCP-based state-of-the-art. Okay, we are seeing about 35 microseconds, whereas TCP was almost 10 milliseconds. Yes.
Would InfinityBand go on the chart? I mean, how fast is FaRM?
Here. So we're not actually getting almost anything on top of what on top of the pure RDMA reads.
Oh, okay.
So we actually ran FaRM on InfinityBand clusters as well, but on some slightly older hardware. So I'm showing these numbers, but this is basically the line. Basically, the latency is sometimes even more important because of applications. So remember, this is a basic building block. We have a hash table. So in order to show a web page to the users, we need to perform lots of these accesses. And often, these accesses depend on the previous one, so we cannot do them in parallel. So the latency matters a lot. For instance, Facebook claims that they cannot implement everything they want, all the functionality they want, because of the high latency of their network. So latency matters a lot. And what typically happens in data centers is that you would trade off some of your throughput for latency, right? In order to get better latency, you would run it at a point where your throughput is lower. So I played a little bit with this, and basically reducing the latency to running at a point where the latency is 1 millisecond actually impacts throughput by a factor of 2.5, okay? And there's no reason to actually play any of these games with FaRM, because we actually have good throughput and good latency at the same time. So we implemented also a graph store, as I already mentioned. So this is basically modeled after Facebook's Tao graph store, in-memory graph store. So we ran the experiment with a redominated workload. So basically 99.8% of all operations are lookups. And we have 10 operation types, which are very, very simple. So these operations are basically used to traverse the graph. So for instance, read the node in the graph or read a bunch of edges according to some criterion. Okay, so quite simple operations. We implemented this on top of FaRM. Nodes and edges are represented as objects. Links between them are pointers. We use lock-free reads to do lookups and transactions for updates, similar to what we do for the hash table. Okay, and we measure the performance on our cluster and compare it to performance published by Facebook. So this is not exactly apples to apples comparison, but this is basically comparison of our system running on our cluster to their system running in production. And we are seeing basically, again, similar results to before. So order of magnitude improvement in throughput per server, and between a factor of 40 and 50 improvement in latency here. Okay, again, very, very significant performance gains when using this new hardware in the right way. Okay, so we ran a bunch of other experiments, and we can talk about this later if you want. But I'll just basically tell you where I see this work, where does it fit. So basically FaRM is a step towards, I see it as a step towards future data centers. So we already today, by running with this modern data center hardware, it's already available and is being deployed in data centers, we can enable new applications. And we've been talking with people and looking into what kind of new functionality, new applications we should actually build on top of FaRM. One of the things is supporting more complex graph processing. I mentioned this graph serving benchmark or graph serving system, and we're actually thinking about doing more complex graphs, for instance, like Satori graph used by Bing. Another interesting thing is scaling out OLTP. So traditionally, OLTP is considered not to scale out well because of the high latencies of the network. By OLTP, I mean transactional processing in databases, okay? So it's considered to not scale out well because of the high overheads of the network. So for instance, it's hard to deploy an OLTP database and scale it out in cloud. So With this, we believe that we can do much better, and we can enable this by using these new networks and keeping the data in memory. And this basically requires some work into figuring out what's the best way of supporting transactions in these kinds of workloads. Also, what other data structures we need. For databases, we typically need some kind of tree data structure for sequential indexes. And we actually built a B-tree, which also performs quite well, but I didn't have time to talk about it. Another thing that's very interesting are these deep neural networks, so deep machine learning in general, which is a very hot topic today. And we talked with some people who believe that actually having a very low latency over the network can improve the learning rate of the algorithms significantly. Okay, and this is what we can basically do on today's hardware, but also FaRM is a great platform for looking into what the future hardware is going to look like in data centers. And this is a great venue for software hardware code design, and we've been starting to explore this, talking with some people at EPFL. So one of the things that we're looking into is basically integrating the network with the CPU, so reducing the overhead of communication between the network card and the CPU, having them on the same chip, which would significantly improve performance. Another thing is what primitives we should put in the network, right? So now we have reads and writes, which are quite simple primitives, but can we benefit from having more complex things like compare and swap or atomically updating objects or doing some simple compression and encoding schemes? And another very interesting things are these non-volatile memories, okay? So these are going to impact how we build and think of systems in general, but they have significant implications on how we do fault tolerance in these kinds of systems. And we are also looking and exploring this, okay? So just to sum up, I presented FaRM. We have a paper at NSDI, so which you can read. You can come talk to me later if you want, if you have any other questions. So FaRM is a platform for distributed computing that uses RDMA extensively and keeps data in main memory. Okay, so we have a shared memory abstraction with transactions and lock-free reads exposed to the programmers, and we enable order of magnitude performance improvements. So if you have any questions, now you can ask too.
One quick one,
yeah.
Do you have any advice for write-dominated workloads?
So, what do you mean? Do we have any?
See, so you showed that the FaRM is optimized for read-dominated
yes.
workloads.
Yes.
What about write-dominated ones?
There are not that many workloads that are very heavily write-dominated. But in systems that are very heavily write-dominated, you might have issues. For instance, if you expose this transactional primitive, and we can implement writes differently. Typically, what we would do is we would try to serialize the writes. For instance, send all the writes for a particular object that is heavily contented to a server. Then the server would serialize these operations and execute them one after another to avoid basically overheads. Okay. And for these kinds of workloads, basically, developer would still benefit from the shared data space and a nice programming model, and from the fast messaging that we have. Yes.
And so, how is that shared address space organized? I mean, what happens when I add new machine to the cluster? Will it just increase somehow this space like linearly, or it could be added in between of existing parts?
This is what you're asking, if the new machine is actually going to take over some of the data
yes.
from the old machines. Yes, yes. So the idea is basically that we reduce the load on other machines by spreading some of the load on the new machine, or on the new machines that we add.
But there is no direct mapping between like local address in each machine and say global.
There is a mapping, yes. We will need to update this mapping, but all accesses to even to the memory of local machine go through the level of through this mapping. So even if a machine, if the program is accessing some local memory,
mm-hmm.
it's going to actually to use this FaRM address, and it's going to map FaRM address into the local address and then perform the access.
And
okay.
Who governs this mapping?
A FaRM. I mean,
FaRM.
Yes. So,
so there is one single machine that governs this mapping or not?
The mapping, so the way we do the mapping is basically the address consists of two parts. One is the offset into the region. We organize the whole space as 2 gigabyte regions, okay? And then essentially what each machine needs to do is to establish the mapping from this prefix, which is 32 bits to extract the region. So what we do today is we are do the consistent hashing, right? We use these consistent hashing rings. So you can map this to the ring and find which server actually is responsible for the machine. Then you can contact the server to get the RDMA capabilities for accessing it. The alternative option which we're actually exploring is to actually have a single server that that keeps all the mappings, and then we would need to, we need to keep the mappings fault tolerant as well, but we can do that too. So, oops. Yes, you had a question.
I wanted to know that TCP has an inbuilt sort of congestion control mechanism.
Yes.
So with FaRM, is there, I mean, is there some sort of mechanism which it helps it to sense whether there's congestion upon these things and not?
So we basically rely at the moment. We rely on the network itself. So basically, it's built in the network. Once the switches cannot handle the traffic or the links cannot handle traffic, they basically send the pause packets to the sender. And then the sender backs off, and this is done completely in the network, so invisible to FaRM or to the application.
So it's not like on the end host; it's rather within the network.
Yes, it happens inside. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. One more question. Since these days there's a lot of talk of any virtualization using VMs.
Yes.
So I mean, as such, FaRM has any issues with virtualization, or it's not an issue?
So we haven't actually tested with virtualization, but it should, in principle, shouldn't be a problem. So these NICs can be virtualized and exposed to the applications running in virtual machines. So this shouldn't be a problem. We haven't actually tested it. So yes, in principle, it works in practice. So, yeah, maybe some issues.
Okay, I think we should probably stop there. Lots of great questions during the talk, and so you're giving the demo. Tomorrow.
Tomorrow, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Great. So thanks to Alexander.